There we go. All right. Yes, recording. So create a short story using the 3D model of an architectural monument, right? Anybody know where that clock is?
Halfway tree.
Halfway tree.
Okay. Okay. Good guess. It wasn't a really good clock myself. But essentially what we're going to do, let me open a program in the background. Good. All right. What we're going to do is I'm going to give you guys a model and you guys are going to come up with a story that involves the model. All right. So let's look a little bit on the detail. Let me go full screen. All right. So on this page is a brief history of the clock. And I put this here so that it can help you guys to determine what your story will be, right? A little bit about how the clock originally came about and just some general information. Now, it doesn't mean that the story that you guys are going to make has to be about the history of the clock. The story can be about Martians from outer space. It could be about the materials that made up the clock. It could be about the buildings that's across the road and not necessarily directly about the clock.
So, sir, question. We'll be given the single monument or building.
You're going to get some context.
Oh, we're going to get some context with it.
Right. I'm going to show you. That's what we're going to do today. I'm going to show you exactly what I'll be giving you. You remember when you guys got the guardhouse?
Yeah.
Which is kind of like a little practice where you get an object that is already digital, and some of you end up using, well, a lot of you end up using Lumion and so forth. And you had to import the model. Some of you probably had to convert it and so forth to get it to be in a workable format. So that was a nice little practice for the bigger fish of what we need to do for the project. All right. Okay. So here is the fun part, right? So during the length of the course, we learned a little bit about digital storytelling.
Zoom in a little bit, please, sir.
Do what?
Zoom in a little bit.
Okay. All right. Come on, guys. Mute your mic if you don't want me to hear in your background. Okay, all right, good. So there are a couple of things that we learned and some of the things we haven't gone through yet, right? We have about two lectures that we need to go through. One of them we're going to go through right after this. And that is looking at plot styles. But we did look at using camera techniques to enhance storytelling. That was basically the practical exercise that you did, right? And most of you did pretty well. I can see where some of you put in some effort in capturing your footage, and some people just said, sure, let's record a 10-second video and hand it to you now, man.
But sir, and that team. Not seeing where the video is uploaded for that, you know.
You're not seeing the?
The video, the upload, or any grade for that for me.
Well, yeah, there are some, I think about 70% or 50% of that one is marked already. So if you're not seeing your work marked, don't be alarmed. But here, what? Any technical issues, I would deal with it a little after. for example, I know that some people were having challenges with the file size because of the limit and so forth. But let me deal with that after. Let me talk about the project, talk about the lecture, and then we deal with technical challenges. All right?
Okay.
All right, so...
Welcome to Brian's Smart Desk.
Oh, Lord.
It's 3:16 Alexa, p.m.
Stop.
Today is Wednesday, March 25th.
Okay.
Alexa,
so, so the assignment should be produced, the following typical, using the typical film production techniques, right? So essentially, we're going to be divided within each group into three parts. I'll zoom back in a little bit. So we have pre-production, post-production, and production, right? And there, typically, it's two persons to a role, right? And what's wrong with my volume? Hello, you can hear me?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, good. Sir.
Okay, yeah. Good. Yeah, so typically it's two persons to a role. So for each team, two persons would be responsible for pre-production, two persons for production, and two persons for post-production, right? And this is where I normally go through to tell you guys what each role requires. Now, the aim is that everybody is supposed to have the choice to decide whether or not they are pre-production, production, or post-production. However, you may not have the choice of who you get to work with because the groups have to be balanced out. But you will never have a group that only has people who are strong in pre-production. You follow me? And then nobody is good in post-production and so forth. And the aim of this is that in any situation, especially in architectural firms, when you have to create any kind of a presentation, especially if it's media, this would be this is like the professional approach that studios like Pixar, these big studios, they would take. Whether you are a big studio or a small firm, breaking down the team into these three roles is usually the best approach. This is what you call an industry standard, basically. All right? So, the pre-production persons, they are responsible for, let me zoom back in so you can see the screen. The pre-production persons are responsible for pulling together of the ideas to form the story, right? So you see, can everybody see that little diagram that's there with those little stick men?
Yes, sir.
Right, so those little stick men that you see. So you see where the guy says, ah, I have an idea. And then he shares that idea and then they create an animatic and then they start to work on it. Essentially, that is the role of a pre-production. And what I'm hoping for is that between the theory assignment and the practicals that you have been doing, you will kind of get an idea if you're good at ideating, right? You hear that word, ideating, or you're better at producing, or you're better at polishing. You follow me?
Are you going to choose these groups based on what you think we're good at?
Well, the truth is that you guys choose who you believe. You guys choose the role that you believe that you're good at. But choosing your role, we actually had a class activity to do that, but that we're going to have to figure out something else for that.
Yeah, because so what if you get a group with four persons who are all good at pre-production, but nobody's good at production?
No, what we normally do it is traditionally we have a class where after we finish all of the work for the semester and everybody has gotten a taste of production, pre-production, and post-production, right? We have a class where we, when people come to the class, it's a first come, first serve kind of basis. There you go. No, when people come to the class, we randomize the names and we pick from a, well, we normally do it on a spinning wheel, Wheel of Fortune style, where we pick people on that list. And every time we choose a person, they decide what role they want to play. You get me? Now, they don't decide what team they want to be in. They decide what role they want to play. You get me? And that is how we used to do it traditionally. So we're going to try to mimic that method. So, for example, the it's not 100%, I would say, proven to work. I mean, in any group situation, there's always a scenario where you don't, where things aren't exactly ideal. But for the most part, it has always worked where most things are ideal. So at minimum, we get to choose what role we want to play, but you have scenarios where you have some people that are good with more than one things. So some people might be good at creating ideas, but that might also be good with production, you know, good with Lumion and 3D Max and those things. And they can choose what role they want to play. And sometimes we ask them if they want to switch roles in order to balance out somebody else's team and that kind of thing. So it's not hard and fast. But the idea is that I want to give you guys the ability to choose based on your skill. Because that's what would happen in the real world firm. If you're good at storytelling, then it would be best that you work on that. If you're good at technical stuff, it would be best your production and so forth. All right, so then we'll go through the assignment quick, and then we can answer some more questions, all right? So where was I? So pre-production. So these members would be responsible for pulling the story together, the creation of the storyboard. The storyboard is a graded item. It's worth 10% of your grade. The storyboard is like your, it's like your design drawing. It's like you're telling me that this is the story that we plan to do. And this is the story that you should expect us to do. So the pulling together of ideas for that storyboard is the responsibility of the pre-production person. So they are the early workers, right? Here is the other part of it, directing the operation of the other two roles to ensure the story is followed. So I've seen in a couple of previous years where persons come up with a story and then what they show is like totally different. So when we're grading this assignment, this major project, one of the criteria that is marked under the pre-production persons is the story, did the story follow through with the storyboard? So if the story is about an apple, then when we watch the final movie, it shouldn't be about a mango. In that case, it's the pre-production person that would have lost points for that criteria, because it's their job to ensure that the story follows through and it's the same thing that was decided on. And the last one is the creation of the script, right? Sometimes there is voice in the story, and the post-production, the pre-production people are the persons who are to oversee the script. Okay? All right, you guys awake?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I guess you're speaking for everybody. All right, cool. Okay, so I mean, I think this assignment is pretty cool. It's been around in CSA for a long while. Okay. Yeah, then give me some more time with Zoom. Okay. Right. So when I was in school, I did this assignment as well, but it was much more difficult because we didn't have as much guidance. You guys have way more guidance, trust me. All right. So the next role is production, right? These are the technical people, the people who know the program good, people who can operate the camera, or they can manipulate the settings in 3D Max or Lumion or Twinmotion or whatever. Maybe your story is about something that you weren't given, and you have to create it. You have to model it from scratch, or you have to download it from a website to use it. These are the technical people that have the know-how of these things, right? And usually in a class, there are a couple of people who are technical. So even in this little diagram here, they do things like layout, R&Ds, research and development. I remember a previous year, they wanted to do something with a bird, but they couldn't get they wanted to know how could I get a bird flying by this building, because the bird was an important thing in their story. So I did a tutorial about how to create a bird and give it to the technical team, and the technical team created the bird, right? But they knew they had to create the bird because from pre-production, it was decided that a bird would be in the story. You follow me? So you see how everything kind of comes together. They do things like rendering, lighting. I mean, this thing here has animating, but you won't be going into like Pixar level stuff, right? We're going to try and keep it simple. And that's why I'm here, to help you guys to make sure you do a film that is within budget. Especially now that we're working remotely, it might be a little more tricky. So we don't expect any blockbuster films with Martians coming from space, or you have to go and rent a location for a day to get a scene for your movie. Definitely, we're not going to go to that level of production. All right? We're going to try and keep it simple and sweet. Okay. So these persons are responsible for creating and manipulating of 3D models and scene, the animating of the camera. So all those camera techniques that you've been learning, I would expect that the production person would know how to execute it, right? Rendering of the draft animation and rendering of the final animation, right? So all rendering is a production. So at the end of the day, the production persons are going to generate these clips. Everybody is going to do the practical assignment, right? And if you realize in the practical assignment, for part 3, the virtual camera, by you reach the virtual camera, everybody should have had 7 clips ready to put on the timeline. Some of the clips were 3D, and some of the clips were clips that they got with their phone, and some of the clips were given to you guys as drone footage. But at the end of the day, everybody are supposed to have these clips that they put together in the video editing program. So the production people are responsible for generating all those clips, right? Everybody understanding me so far?
Yeah. Sir.
All right. Any questions so far? You want to ask any questions? Probably we have to use the raise hand feature if it gets a bit cumbersome. But any questions?
I don't have any.
Nope. Silence from everybody else. Okay. So everybody understand completely. right?
Yes.
Okay. For now, yeah.
Yeah, I need a feature in Zoom that you know, like a yes or no button. But okay. All right. Okay, so that is the production people, right? They get the job done. Now, when they give when all of those clips are created, right? So if your story is about a clock and about how the clock was put together, the pre-production people decide what the story should be about. You tell the production people, say, hey, I need a video of the clock being created, being animated together, or I need a video of the clock exploding, or I need a video of somebody walking past the clock, right? The production people are to produce those clips. Then they're going to hand those clips over to the post-production people, right? And this is the thing. The post-production persons, you're pretty much doing what you did with the part three of the virtual camera, right? You are sourcing production assets like music, sound effects, visual effects, fonts. You're managing the timing of the transitions. I hope all of you watch the tutorial that I made for you guys, just for you guys, out of sweat and effort, right? So that you could be guided on how to create a good production, right? So
thank you, sir.
Good. Things like you're welcome. Things like timing and how you time the music with the rhythm of the music and so forth is what I expect to see now. And the post-production persons are responsible for that. So, of course, their responsibilities would be combining all the media into a single timeline and produce the final video, right? So those are the main three roles. And the truth is that, I mean, I know at the end of the semester, most people are hustling to do the least amount of work. And I understand that. And we try to make the course less burdensome, because we know that studio is real, right? But between these roles, sometimes a person will pick a role because I think that role is easier and is less work. So right off the bat, some people would say, well, boy, I think the production role is too much work.
Welcome to Brian's Smart Desk. Ah. It's 3:33 p.m.
Alexa, stop.
Today is Wednesday, March 25th.
All right. So, right, sorry about that. Alexa has been bad. All right, so, right. So the truth is that, and I can just tell you the secrets from now. Yes, the production people need to create or gather most of the assets. But most assets that you use aren't things that will necessarily be created from scratch. Like, I wouldn't expect you to be modeling a whole Shrek character or a Disney character from scratch and animating the arms and the legs and all of those things. No. Most of your work will be gathering assets and at minimum doing the camera positioning with those assets. If you are technically minded, it is best that you go in the production side, right? Now, once those production, so basically the person on the production team going to be saying, what video should I do? And the pre-production and everybody decide, and the pre-production give production team and say, hey, I need 5 different clips and this is what I want the clips to show. Then the mission of the production team is to create those clips. That is it, right? Now, the pre-production and post-production roles are roles that are less technical, especially the pre-production, but it have more responsibility. So the pre-production role has the most responsibility and the least technical requirement. Pre-production, you're basically responsible to guide the whole story, filtering the ideas from everybody and coming up with the story. So that's like a big responsibility. It don't mean you have to render the thing and model the thing, but you have to, you determine basically how much work everybody does. And then you have to guide everybody through the process. So it is a managerial kind of a role. You guys did advanced computing one where you talk about team and managing a team and all that kind of stuff. So that is where that comes into play. Now, the post-production is kind of the middle ground of technical and responsibility. Post-production main challenge is the emotion. The film is either boring, dry, or exciting because of the post-production people. Right? In post-production, somebody might give you 5 different clips and say, give me a presentation that I can feel. Now, if you just throw those clips on a timeline and throw a music to it, it's going to be flat. You get me? So the post-production people's challenge is to evoke emotion. So for those of you who did the virtual camera and you find that you had a connection with that and you could do it good and you like doing that thing, then that is your role, right? You're not responsible to generate the videos. You're not responsible for the entire storyline. What you are responsible for is the emotion, that final polishing video, the little sound effect and the clips going according to the video. That is what you guys are responsible for. So I'm just saying this to say each of these roles has their own challenge. None of them is easier, really. There are just different types of challenges. Okay? All right, so any question on that whole explanation of those three roles? Or maybe I should ask you guys some questions. Does this sound doable? Let me ask that first one. Anybody?
Yes, sir.
Let me ask another one. Does it sound fun and exciting?
Not really.
So you're not really looking forward to doing this?
Not really.
What would you rather do? Don't say nothing. That's not an answer. Oh, yeah. No answer?
So we just hate Cooper. We just hate the group.
You just want to leave?
No, we hate group work.
Oh, group. Okay. Yeah. Well, I was debating. This is always a debate. And every time I have this discussion, I have this assignment, and I explain these roles, that's when some say, okay, I understand why it's group work and so forth. Do you believe then that if I
ask why are y'all trying to make us do something, and why are y'all trying to get us to do group work when we already find it difficult to communicate with each other during this?
That's a very good question. And as a matter of fact, I was asking that question around and I got mixed reviews. It could be that everyone does their own movie. But the truth is that some people might not be good with each of these roles. As a matter of fact, when I was doing this course, when I was doing the degree, it was not group work. I think the research component of it was group work. So for example, it would have been that you would have researched the clock and then everybody would have done their own movie. You follow me? But over the years, yeah, that kind of changed, because this course isn't really about research. It's kind of about applying new ways of expressing architecture. So it's about the movie, not really about the research. So it became more closer to production, and then hence that's where a team comes in. But guess what? I mean, it is something that I was grappling with. Should you guys do the work as group or should you do it as team? If I was to do a vote and give you guys a form and let you vote, and it worked out that most people say, boy, they will do everything by themselves. Is that everybody's approach?
Sorry, question. Is it six persons to a group?
That's what we try to do. Some groups will end up with more. Would have ended up with more.
Okay.
All right. Mm-hmm. So the thing is that, okay, even though it's group work, and I know the situation is different now, but even though it's group work, I would have met with you, I would have met with each group, usually like two or three times to find out what is happening and so forth. And that usually helps the process, right? Sometimes I hear of stories of, you know, not everybody in the group did work and so forth and so forth. But for the most part, you are graded individually. And this is why most people go along with it. The group grade is 50% and the individual grade is 50%. So let me sum it up. The entire project is worth 40%. It's a major project. 10% of that is for the storyboard, where you hand in a sheet or two that has a storyboard on it that says, this is the movie that I'm making. And it's just sketches, like stickman sketches, not elaborate works of art, right? It's just a sequential list so that I have something to compare what you gave me to the end result. That is 10% of the grade. That leaves 30%. 15% out of that is given to each pair of persons. So, for example, if the pre-production persons, let's see, the story was followed throughout the whole process, and basically how well the story matches up to the storyboard, that's their 15%, right? There's also a component, there's also a leadership component of it that I usually put my own grade to based on what I observe from the group, right? Because the pre-production people are basically like the group leaders. The post-production and the production, they all get their own 15%, and that 15%, it goes to the peer of people that were doing the work. The other 15%, everybody gets, and that is based on the final production. So even though it's group work, you still have 50% of the work being individualized or in pairs, put it that way. So what do you guys think of that? You still require that it be group work or individual work?
So I think it will be hard to get through to some persons.
Yeah, like some persons don't have internet, some persons don't have the program, some persons don't have this, that, and
so forth. So it might be tricky. Like,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, like we know our class.
Okay. So, and a lot of this, sometimes you can judge from your, from what is happening in studio. So from what is happening in studio, you think that communication going to be a major thing?
Yeah.
Yeah? All right. Well, how about this? What if I give you guys the option, right? If you're going to do it in a group, right, I would let you guys choose. And you would have to, I would give you complete freedom in determining your group members. But if you would rather to do it as an individual, you give me the individual. But if you're doing it as a group, the minimum persons that you have to use is three
work.
Persons.
Work.
Three.
Work.
No, because there are three roles.
That's three roles.
Right. So the minimum persons you have to use is three. As a matter of fact, that would be the maximum and the minimum, because it wouldn't be fair that you have a group that have six and a group that have three,
and then somebody by themselves
is either by themselves or three to a group. And you guys choose, so you pick your own destiny based on the current situation. How that sound?
So you want to do the voting form first? Because we have a lot of persons who could not join the call today. So,
how much people I see here? There is
21. This is just half the class. This is just half the class.
21 participants.
20, excluding you.
All right. I was in a BIM online thing today, and it was only a third of the class. This is the biggest Zoom meeting I've seen. Wow.
Some of them said that they are having problems with the flow connection. They can't access certain things.
As a matter of fact, this meeting was almost called off. I just got internet back 10 minutes before 3 o'clock.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know the challenge, but you see the thing? You know, sometimes you might have a band of people that they normally work well together and they do work, and they happen to be in good communication, and they can, you know, so I don't have to vote. You guys can just choose. You can choose to work by yourself or in groups of three. Right?
Okay.
The group of six might be too complicated, too bulky with all the communication challenges, but a group of two would be too little.
So, question.
Yeah.
But this whole thing, are you using Premiere Pro?
You can use any program. That's the thing about AC2. You can use any video editing program. I found the one that I built, the tutorial one, HitFilm, because I realized
that was good. I found HitFilm.
Can you build that video for Premiere Pro, please?
For Premiere Pro?
Sorry, you know, please. I don't conjure these things up.
I don't conjure these things up in here.
Sir, I want you to make a video for Premiere Pro, so I'd like you to make a video for Premiere Pro.
Yeah, but if you use HitFilm, it's the same thing. It's literally the same thing. Come on.
But I don't have that.
It's free. It's free.
It's free. Absolutely free. Yeah. I was surprised. And that's why I actually tested it out, because in the previous years, most of the other ones, you know, you have a watermark or you have some really bad.
The 2013 has the watermark. The 2014, I don't think it has the watermark. But for the 2013, it's free. You just need to create an account. And then once you create an account, you can remove the watermark for the 2013.
Alexa, stop.
Wednesday, March 25th.
Okay, hang on a bit.
There is one event in progress. AC2 practical. Okay. Brian lasts until 7 p.m.
Okay, good. She quiet now. Okay, yeah. So you say in 2013?
Yeah, the 2013, you will have the watermark on it when you're doing the video editing, but right, you can create an account, and it shows you how you create an account, and then once you create an account now, you can remove the watermark.
This is for Premiere Pro?
No, not for Premiere Pro. HitFilm Express.
Oh, yeah, man. Once you create a water, okay. I thought that you all created an account.
Some people just skip that part because, like, they just want to create the.
Yeah, I get you. Yes, definitely. Yeah, man. You need to create the account and you don't get the water. Yeah. But the HitFilm is pretty cool. And if you use Premiere Pro, like me, to do this film, it's more than acceptable. If you have access to Premiere Pro and you're good at Premiere Pro, then you just work with that. Or for those of you big bad boss people that use the After Effects, even though I don't too recommend it, it's a bit complex, but you can use the After Effects. But we can sign and stamp and seal that deal. A group, either individual or groups of three, and you give me that information. I don't want to get one information, so I will send out, I will do a form and send out the form to all your emails, and you just select on the form your group mate's name that you want to be in a group with, and you, or you can just select your individual, and then I will set up my grading sheet based on that.
So, question.
Yeah.
What are we focusing on, the clock tower? That's what we're doing.
Okay, so let's continue with this. So we finished talking about the team part. Okay, so you're seeing the screen now? So what you have is a simplistic kind of mock-up of the halfway tree area, including the clock tower. Now, the story that you make, it doesn't have to be centered around the clock tower, but it must involve it in some way. It can be a background object character, but it must be involved some way in the story. So let me just read one part here. So you are to tell an architectural story that is interesting, invigorating, and thought-provoking using the 3D model provided. Your story must remain grounded in the framework of architecture. But that little one phrase here is important, because we don't want to get too wacky and create, you know, things that don't really have anything to do with architecture at the end of the day. You follow me? So it must still have to be about something involving architecture, even if it is fictional, right? You know, it could be, you know, in the year 2050, you know, this is what you think the clock tower is. Or it could be about the past when there was no clock tower. You know, it whatever the story is, it needs to to be grounded in some form or something about architecture. Now, to achieve this, you must select an aspect, element, or concept about the building as the basis of your story and expound on it using the storytelling techniques learned in the course. So the story could be about the finger of the clock on the clock tower. And your story could just be about the finger. You get me? So you're choosing there an aspect or an element, or your story could be about the clock tower itself, or it could be about the area. The story is about that area that the clock tower is in. It varies. However you want to ground your story, but it must include something about the clock tower, or something about the clock tower must be a part of your story. Right. Okay, assignment requirements. The final video must be no longer than 7 minutes. I decided to put this here because 1 year I got a film that was 20 minutes long and it didn't need to be that long, right? So I don't expect we to do things like 15 minutes is pushing it. You get me? 5 minutes, fine. 3 minutes, fine. It's like a short film. The production must be handed in before the deadline date, which is currently not determined. 500 megabytes is what I give you guys this year, right? As you might realize, I'm giving you guys limits because every year AC2 keeps finishing my Google Drive space, right? So 500 megabytes is what I'm giving you. Right, and it must have like music and all these things. Okay, and we spoke about the individual grade and the group grade. So I spoke about that aspect already.
Excuse me. Could you just specify what the minimum time is, please, again?
Well, I'm going to say the minimum time is
1 minute?
30 seconds? Oh, yeah, okay. I mean, I don't know. If you can build a movie in 1 minute, that is, and I quote, interesting, invigorating, and thought-provoking, right? Right? Don't forget that. So it can't just be presenting the clock tower. built in, whatever, the end. That story is not invigorating or interesting. You understand? So I'm just saying you have to meet those criteria as well, all right? And that is more on the group grade side of things. But remember, pre-production persons, you guys are responsible for especially that invigorating and thought-provoking and, you know? Right. The whole group must pitch in, you know? But, well, I guess no, that's just really one person. But anyway.
So, question. You have 15% for group and 15% for individual. So what if you decide to work on your own?
Well, I just mark you. I just
out of the 30.
Right, I just mark you out of the 30. Right. So right. So I will have to adapt my grading criteria to that. But
sure.
Based on the current situation, and that I won't give you that option. Yeah. Next question.
Yes. So in terms of the pre-production and the post-production aspect, what if someone decides to overlap between the two processes? How does the grading work there?
Well, if you're in a group and you decide to overlap, then legally, I am going to grade the person who I have their name down as the pre-production and post-production and so forth based on what I watch in the video. So you can do any amount of overlapping or swapping, but on my end, all I can do is grade the production person based on what I see in the video, even if the production person did the pre-production work. I mean, you can speak to me if like it's a genuine swap, but I mean, if you're just working and you decide to mix and model everything, then you know I can't mix and model the grade. I have to just stick with the names that I have.
Okay.
Right. So a little bit about the model, right? So you have this model here. I actually modeled most of this, and a couple of guys from my office, you know, they did a one building or something. So in the bottom half is the model, and the top half is the picture. So you're provided this model. It's originally done in 3D Max 2016. But it can be, I gave you FBX, DWG, and SketchUp. Right? So you can, you know, go whichever direction you want, hopefully from these files. Because this is a movie, it's not about, what do you call it? Like, I'm not grading you like, does the object have materials? Is the shadows right? Things like that are, if your story demands that the model is a clay model, then that's your story. There is a criteria to grade on the overall quality of the movie, but it's not down to the individual things as what we used to do in like 3D modeling or those other, or DDM, where we're teaching you the individual elements of rendering. This is totally up to you to represent it in whatever way that you want for your story. All right. So I've pretty much gone through the handout. I will place a submission button somewhere on this thing so that you guys can submit the work. We have one more item to finish for today. I just wanted to get the main thing out. Full screen. In your, on the class site, I have also put a PDF here, right? And this PDF has to do with storyboarding and plot styles, right? And when I say plot styles, I don't mean like AutoCAD, right? I mean plot like Feitag's pyramid. So I have actually gone against my typical rule, and I've included the videos in the PDF, right? I normally remember I always leave out the videos for people who don't come to class, but technically our class is now online, so I've given you everything. So I think if you're watching the PDF though, when you download it, you have to install Flash in order to see the videos in the PDF. But for what we're doing now, I'm just gonna show you it in PowerPoint, right? So, oops, not there. Come on. Yeah, I think because I'm recording the video, it's moving a little sluggish. Okay, so open and intro to storyboard in 2020. All right, so what I'm going to do is just make this full screen, hide this, and hide that. All right? Yeah, there we go. Okay, so this is pretty short, don't worry. I think it will finish before you guys fall asleep, right? I mean, I can imagine if you drop asleep in class and you're at home now in your bed watching this. No, you're going to drop asleep. Anyway, so especially the persons who want to do the pre-production role, right? Well, and if persons want to take on the whole movie by themselves as well, because they are their own pre-production, production, and post-production person. This is what I'm expecting to get as a storyboard, right? Remember, the storyboard is 10% of your grade. So, for example, if you decide to go it alone, then when you give me a storyboard, that is 10% of your individual grade. If it's for the group, then when you give me that storyboard, it is 10% of the group grade, right? And if you follow that storyboard, it is that part of the grade is for the pre-production person's grade. You get me? So anyway you take it, you do need to know how to create a storyboard, right? So I have this put together so you can quickly see what a storyboard is like. So a storyboard is a graphic representation of how your video would unfold shot by shot. Right, so if you look on this story, where, and I hope everybody kind of seen it clearly, right?
Yep.
On this storyboard, notice you see a word here. You have a frame. It has a short description here, right? I remember when you guys got the storyboard from Images Theory assignment. And I asked for a description. Some people gave me a novel, not calling any name. We know ourselves, right? But a storyboard really just has a short kind of description here to say door closing. That's all that needs to be. Right? Then notice you see another word here, cut. Because in order to go to the next scene, it's just going to cut and go to where the person is going in a bag. So notice that these titles, it has one description for two slides. Everybody seen that?
Yes.
So, and it says this scene has no background, only color that should change as the scene progresses. So notice you have, I can understand what this story is saying based on the description below, description above, and how you transition to the to that part, to that slide. So, all right. Notice that at the beginning again, you see this pull back. So this would be, for example, like one of the camera motions that we learned about. Right?
Yep.
So for example, if you want to say that, okay, for this scene, the camera is pulling back or pull out, right? so that the person who is working in production, who is making this, will know that, oh, I need to animate this camera backwards, zooming out, or zooming in, or doing a parallax, or whatever it is. And then there's a description also here. All right, she drops the bag and puts the shoes in her lap. So if you were in like a Disney studio where you're doing fancy animation and character rigging, this would be how you know how to animate your character, right? Then notice here, there's another transition that says pullback. So that means the camera is zooming out, and end of the pullback, she's putting on one shoe.
Then
she admires it. All right, so in a nutshell, that is really all we're asking for a storyboard. It's not a big production that you have to do a whole lot of work, but it must have some basic information. So for example, if a group or an individual hands in a storyboard and the storyboard is it doesn't tell me anything about the transition or what I'm seeing, then it's incomplete. On the other hand, if you remember when you did the storyboard from images exercise, some of us did stories that didn't connect, meaning the first part of the story was disconnected from the last. So the flow of the story wasn't like consistent. So the story started about an apple, and when the story ended, it was about a dog. You follow me? So pre-production persons, yeah, that is your responsibility to make sure that the story is consistent. So if you guys had a good run with your theory exercise and you think that you understood it good, and a good grade would be the evidence of that, right? So then you could say, well, I think I should take on the role of pre-production, right? Because I think I can tell a good story, okay? So anyway, that is what a storyboard is. Now, this I do is a little close-up. On the more professional setting, people will add like arrows on their storyboard, and they will add like additional information like timing and editing notes and frame numbers. All of this is important, but it varies. So you might, you know, but I expect that if you guys go into a firm and they say, hey, there's a next Houses of Parliament competition, maybe it's another King's, maybe it's a King's House upgrade competition, and all architects are required to submit a short film, right? I would hope that you guys coming out of this course would, you would immediately say, well, first thing we need to do is have a production group, pre-production, post-production, and blah, blah, blah. And I learned this in advanced computing too. Thank goodness, right? Okay, so before you just jump into Revit or Studio Max or Lumion, you would need to design what your story is, and you need to do your storyboard. And when you're presenting the story to your boss, I would expect that you guys would present something like this. And then your boss can immediately look at it and say, yeah, man, this sounds like a good story. Right? Mm-hmm. And I can tell you that some of us do these stories and we don't. Some firms, they don't think about it this way. They just kind of throw clips together and it just kind of, you know, dry and stuff. So you guys are who is making the revolution. All right, so guess what? I have a video in this presentation. So I think if I'm going to show the video, I have to mute my mic or else you're going to get a echo. So I'm going to play this example. I'm only going to play a short amount of it. While it's playing, I'm going to mute the mic. And then when it's done playing, I'm going to unmute the mic. I will go from there. All right. So this what you're about to see is an example of a storyboard and a final product, right? So the top screen is showing the final product and the bottom screen is showing the storyboard that was created from it. And I want you guys to look at how they summarized everything that is happening in the top screen in a storyboard in the bottom screen. All right. So let's start that now. So let me Why did this not let me mute this thing? Okay, mute. I think I'm asking my computer to do too much because it is recording while playing two videos, so it's a bit. All right, let me try again. Hold on.
3 days must open to search.
Right, I know, man, but I can manage it, man.
Yeah, if it.
Maybe PowerPoint can't play two. Oh, it can't play two. Those bastards. All right, hang on, let me. Yeah, okay, everybody still seeing the screen?
Yep.
Okay, good. All right, we're gonna try this now. Hold on. Okay, guess what? Apparently I can't mute the mic while playing a slide, so you might end up hearing the echo. So hang on. Ready again?
Yeah, ready.
Mm-hmm. Okay, here we go.
Welcome to Brian's Smart Desk. The time is 4:05 p.m.
Alexa, stop.
Are we supposed to hear anything?
Yeah, I'm not hearing nothing either.
Mic mute.
So it's very soft.
It's a move frame by frame to me.
Okay, you guys still there?
Yep.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Okay, so yep. I don't know how that played for you guys over the internet. You could see the two moving simultaneously?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay. So, right. So basically, at the bottom, you could see how it's a simple sketch. And the top, you can see the actual production. So, for example, if you look at when the drone came out, right? And this is a pretty cool story. So you guys can watch it on the PDF that I sent you, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where is that part with the drone? I think it's about right here, right?
So we need to do a video sketch as well, like a sketch, like what that.
No, this is called an animatic, and if you were in Edna Manley or in a film school, you would have had to submit the bottom part, and then you submit the top part. But as you say, remember what we're doing in architecture, we're just taking pieces of what people already use and we're catering it to architecture. So at minimum, you have to do a storyboard, right? Mm-hmm. In this case, this is really called an animatic because it almost follows the actual film, you know, frame by frame. Now, of course, the quality of what you're seeing here in the bottom half and what you see in the top half is totally, you can see that the top half has more production level things.
Mm-hmm.
Going through. There we go. This is the part that, okay. So notice this drone. And I mean, that drone is looking pretty cool up there. But then down here, it's basically like a stick man.
Yeah.
And that's all that's required of you for the storyboard, right? We don't expect it to be producing this. This is good enough. And if you say this has a gun, and notice that it doesn't look exactly the same because at this stage, you may not know what the final thing will look like. That is for your production team member to work out. Because he's a technical mind, right? Or she.
Mm-hmm. So as the pre-production, the first part they had only 9 frames. So the video will be based off of the 9 frames that they do in the animation. In the
right, but in this case is not 9 frames. It's any amount of frames you want to submit.
Okay, done.
It just needs to tell your story. Okay, so, sorry, all right, so an architect also.
Sorry, but you see how that one followed it like frame by frame exactly? Does our storyboard have to follow it?
No, you don't have to. Like, I'm not expecting you, I'm expecting that somebody would give me like 9 frames, almost like what you did with your picture from the assignment, the theory assignment. So don't try to give me like 500 frames, frame by frame. No. All right?
Okay.
But I don't want to put a limit on how much you should give me. If you believe that 10 frames can tell the story you want to tell, then fine.
Okay.
All right. So an architect also needs to tell his or her story to the client. And... I have this other video here, and this is pretty cool. This is, we know this building, right? Do we know this building?
Frank Lab, right?
Okay, good. Yeah, the internet is back.
Yes, it's back.
So, I'm going to play just a piece of this film. It's pretty cool, but you can watch all of it on the in the PDF when you download it. All right? Mom, you know this building? This is a residence now. Look. It's a famous architectural building called Falling Water. It was built over a waterfall, a house. It's a famous building. Still aware. It's in the US, run by Frank Lloyd Wright. And they don't show you how it was constructed. It was built over a waterfall. All right, anyway, guys.
Can you see this, sorry.
All right, so I'm going to pause this. So basically, this story is pretty straightforward. It's telling you, you know, how the building was constructed, right?
So the one thing I want to see.
So it's online first to view.
Yes, it's online for you to view. Remember, when you download the PDF, it prompted me to install Flash in order to view it, right? So you probably have to do that as well. right? But this is the example of this typical story is usually told, right? And if you think about it, the drawings that an architect give you is kind of telling you how the building will be built. You know, I give you the site plan and the elevation, the floor plan and all of that stuff. But I mean, if you show a client this, I mean, it's like it's saying the same thing, but you're evoking more emotion from the client, you know?
Yeah.
So they feel more inclined to go in their pockets, you know, one would say, or to give you the contract or whatever. So this one is pretty cool. I don't remember the source. I think I got it from a company. A company was hired to rebuild it. Well, a firm, maybe it's Nearscape, right? But anyway. But guess what? So we have kind of strayed away from this kind of story. This story is like when you watch them old Western, you know, it's pretty typical. Nowadays, we tell more exciting stories. Oh, crap. Right. So I will start that again. Right. And let me just get WhatsApp on here. So I'm in a class. All right. So what was I looking at? No, I was looking at, intro to storyboarding. Right. Okay. And let's see if we can get it back. All right. So now let's talk about this. Now we recognize this one, right? Fatog's triangle. Where you were required to make a story, but the story was using the plot technique of Fatog's triangle, where you had to have an exposition, a conflict, a rising action, a climax, and so forth, right? And some of you got that real good, and some persons kind of struggled with it. But guess what? This is, of course, is not the only way to tell a story. You don't have to start with a, you know, with an exposition and so forth. As a matter of fact, you have some stories nowadays that starts and it starts as saying 3 years ago, you know? So yeah. I'm showing this to say that these are some other popular plot techniques to tell a story. The hero's journey, Kitsento, I can't remember how to pronounce this thing. Kishon Tenketsu, right? Yeah, that's it, right? Essentially, a twist, a plot twist. We're used to this already, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then we have the episodic, which is, you know, it happens every week. Every week you watch an episode of a movie. So, and I have some examples of each, but I don't know if we can watch it in this session. I'm going to leave it for you to watch because I put some pretty cool movies in these. Actually, this movie is pretty cool. Were you guys able to see those other movies I was showing you?
Mm-hmm. Move a little bit.
Okay, here what? Let's leave that till after, right? Because I have one that I definitely want to show you. I'll leave you to watch these, but this is pretty cool. And the important thing, when you watch it, see if you can identify, you know, the exposition and conflict and all that kind of stuff. Hero's Circle. Oh, don't tell me you crash again. Really? Ah. You got to be kidding me.
There it goes, sir.
Yeah. Right. Maybe I shouldn't go full screen. Here, what? I will just use my editing screen so that way, because remember that I'm recording this, so that's probably why it's doing that.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Hero's Journey. A good example of that kind of plot technique is okay, everybody know that movie already, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good.
Yep.
So that's kind of like the hero's journey, where it's not necessarily following a Fatak's pyramid, but it's more following a thing of call to adventure, teacher's helper, threshold of adventure, monsters are a challenge, supreme ordeal, all this kind of thing. And typically Disney movies follow this kind of plot technique. Right?
Yeah.
So I'm showing this to you guys because I want you to be thinking about what type of scenario would I want to create for this architectural movie, right? Okay, this one is pretty cool. This is a real old-time movie, but this was, I believe, it is said to be the first movie that ever had a twist. And then after that, you know, everybody started to follow, you know, and all these things, right? So, you know, when you think that something is going to happen, but then the opposite of that thing happens. It's basically following Fatak's pyramid, but then it twists you at the end before the conclusion or the resolution, you know? Mm-hmm. So you can consider this kind of approach as well, right? And this is an example of the first film that executed that, and everybody in the world was like, oh my goodness, how could it end like this, you know? Mm-hmm. All right, episodic, that's pretty straightforward. Everybody, most people know some of these things, you know, every week. So every week is like a little Fatak's pyramid, basically. Right? Okay. Right. And some of them actually continues. However, modern 20th century shows tends to combine all of them together. So you think about a show like a Game of Thrones, and I know some of you watch Game of Thrones. We were already disappointed, right?
Yep.
But guess what? I still leave this in my presentation, because I think the first time I did this was the class after the episode, The Red Wedding, and everybody was pretty upset about that episode. For those of you who watch Game of Thrones, you know what I'm talking about. But for those of you who haven't, then it's fine. But basically, I'm saying that they're able to combine, you know, all of these different plot techniques to give you a very interesting, invigorative story, right? So it's not saying that you have to use Fatak's pyramid only, or you have to, you know, you can combine them together. And there are many more, even some that I hear is invented. And I do believe if you're in like film school, they would ask you to invent one, right? But
so we must include some of these plot development.
I would say consider it when you're coming up with your movie.
Oh, it's not a requirement.
It's not a requirement. So I'm not going to be looking for establishing shot and blah, blah, blah. You already know that already.
Okay.
But what happens is that a lot of times when we're asked to make a presentation or our architectural walkthrough, we don't think about plot styles. We normally just kind of throw stuff together.
Yeah. But
I'm introducing this to you because you could make a simple architectural walkthrough interesting by adding an element, by using an approach from a filmmaker's point of view. Oh. And you get your audience to be emotionally involved, which makes your walkthrough all that more interesting. That's like a whole new approach. Now you might be thinking I'm telling you something that don't that maybe is saying, well, firms don't normally do that. But can I tell you what is happening normally in like places like New York when somebody says, hey, I want to do an office building and I want to preview my design to the client. They no longer just put thing on a walkthrough and send to the client. You know, this is what they do nowadays, right? So you guys can take a look on this, right? Those who sleep in, wake up. Okay, no, that's a bad example. It's this one. So check this out. This is pretty cool. No. This one is cooler. There it is. Pause, sorry. Nope. You see, I don't have my slide thingy, so I don't know when I'm on the right side. All right, got it. It's this one. Here we go. Come on, don't crash.
Oh, gosh.
Oh, boy. Okay. Again. It's coming back. Don't worry.
Titanic. You have to wait.
No, not waiting. I'm just gonna kill it.
So why don't you stop recording this session, seeing that it's causing so much problems?
Why don't stop this?
Recording the session.
No, nah, man, because it's not everybody here. So, you know.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I rather, I'll go through these crashes to make sure that I only do it once.
Okay.
And not everybody.
Yeah, it makes sense.
And I'll just upload this to my channel and on YouTube, and then you guys can you can point everybody to that location. All right, we are back. I think it was this one. Let's go back full screen. All right, and go. This is a walkthrough, by the way.
Welcome to Robin's Smart Desk. It's 4:32.
Okay, you guys still with me?
Yes, sir.
Right, so, I mean, if we were in class in the studio and watch that on, like, surround sound and big screen, it would feel more appropriate. But, you know, when you watch it in the sides, you can do that for yourself. But yeah. A couple things here, right? So, firstly, we have some text. And I don't know how the audio sounds for you guys, but it should be going according to the video. So you notice when the video change, the video and the audio goes together.
Mm-hmm.
What is the story though? The story is, okay, well, these glass windows are flying throughout the city, right? And this dude is doing his regular desk job, he's in his really boring looking office, and then he notices, hey, there's glass flying outside. Right? So this story has live action. He goes to the window and he's like, hey, what's happening? And the building is actually coming apart while he's in there. And essentially what is happening is that, of course, they're saying that the building is going to be renovated, right?
Yeah.
But rather than just, you know, in a boring way saying, okay, we're going to change all the glass panels to curtain walls and blah, 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 it created a story where the building started to change around this person. And he said, whoa, what's happening? And look, it even previewed what the typical paneling system would look like for each infill and how the whole thing will come together. Then it started to show some of the adjustments that they're going to make to the building, right? And a little bit of show inside the building and so forth. And then it's back to this guy. This is the ending now, saying, hey, I'm in my new office now, and it's pretty cool. And the whole office came together with him in there. You get me?
Yeah.
So that's just a way more exciting way of saying, hey, we're going to renovate this building. So that's what I mean by, you know, you tell a story with, you have the opportunity to do that rather than just doing the typical, you know, here is the entry and the elevation and that kind of stuff, right? So I believe that's actually the last slide. So that is the presentation on a whole on to storyboarding. And that's what I want to tell you guys so that you can now start to think about what story you would do for your final project, right? So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to send out a form that you guys will either fill out whether you're going to tackle this thing in groups of threes or individually, so that I will know how to grade everybody, right? And we're going to have another meeting tomorrow. And that meeting tomorrow, we're going to just confirm the groups. I'm going to show you the result of what we have. And we need to also clear up whatever is missing or technical challenges you're having with the previous assignment, right?
One last question, sir. Mm-hmm. If it's group of three, in terms of the grading thing again, are the assigned assignment of persons pre and post? So it can be like, it would be more than likely be like two persons to post and one person to pre or something like that.
No, but we're agreeing that we're only making groups of one or three.
Yeah, I understand.
Because if it's groups of four, then everybody, it would have to be either one or four to make
it clear. I'm saying that it's still three, you know, it's still three, but I'm saying that within the group, it's like right. Two persons out of the group would be assigned to post, and the one remaining person would have to assign to the pre, or it can be vice versa that way.
No, it would be, you would have to designate to me, out of the three persons, one would have to be for post, one would have to be for pre, and one would have to be for...
And what the other one do?
Production. Remember, it's three roles, you know? It's pre-production, true. Production, and post-production. Right. It's three roles. So if we look on the... Right, it's on the... Here we go. So it's three roles that we have to do.
Oh.
Right. And close that. Right. And if you don't remember what each role do, just look on your handout and you'll see just a quick bullet list of what you have to do. Right?
Okay. Yeah, man, no problem.
Right. Now, so what happens now is that you have to speak to me as a group or as an individual before you hand in your storyboard. Because remember, this assignment, the first thing we're doing is that we need to upload a storyboard. That's the first thing. And then we do the movie. Before you upload your storyboard, you must speak to me, because typically some people budget too much of a big movie that they can't actually produce because they don't have the resources. So I don't want you guys to meet up on that brick wall. So between No, I guess on the next, no, after I get the groups, after that, then you can speak to me. So when I send out the form, as long as you have told me whether you're working individual or in a group, then we can meet about your story and we can talk about it and then you can hand in your storyboard. So okay. You can start working on your story. All right.
Yeah, man.
Okay. So I guess that is our class for today, right? If you remember how we keep it in contact, the first main way how we keep it in contact is via the class site on the forum. If you need a more immediate answer, you can get me on WhatsApp, right? But I don't want to be answering questions on WhatsApp that five people can ask me the same thing. So that's why I say, do the forum first. I'm pretty much in front of my computer all the time now. So as soon as I see a message pop up, I will answer it on the forum. All right? Okay, guys. So that ends our meeting. I hope this recording was done. Right, it should be. And I will put it on the site. Where can I put it now? I'll put the link. I'll put the video on the class site so you can watch it from YouTube.
Okay, sir. Right?
Okay. All right. Wish you guys all the best. If you need to contact me, just whether you the forum or the WhatsApp. All right?
Okay.
All right. So take care and stay safe.
You too, sir.
All right. Thanks again, sir.
Your hand.
Thank you.
All right.